Hi, this is the first part of my multi-part series on time series modeling. And in this part, I will be giving an overview of time series data. In the next part, I will be talking about various modeling techniques like ARIMA or Facebook Prophet or even like LSTM sequence modeling. So I'm talking about various modeling techniques, but in this video, I'm going to more focus on giving an overview about time series data and also the concepts involved within time series pattern, right? So let's get started. Now, what is time series, right? Time series is simply a series of data point ordered in time. Now, when forecasting time series data, the aim is to estimate how the sequence of observation will continue in the future, right? Now, the observation that are collected are typically, it can be collected, data can be collected every second or every minute or hour, right? Or it can be daily, monthly, quarterly, or yearly. So basically, if you are running an IoT sensor or something like that, the data is coming continuously, streaming continuously. But if you're talking about weather data, maybe you get weather updates every hour or even every 10 minutes, 20 minutes. If you're talking about smart electric meters, you may maybe get data every 15 minutes or 30 minutes. So depending on the source of generation, you may have various frequency at which the data is collected. Right now, the major assumption of time series is it assumes that the past pattern and behavior will continue in the future, and that's the main assumption that we make when we are modeling time series data. Now, some of the examples of time series data is your monthly sales data. If you are running an organization or if you are a retail company, you may have your monthly sales data, or any listed company may publish their quarterly or annual revenue. You have hourly weather data, wind speed data, your IoT sensors that are installed in all the industrial devices that continuously generates data. And your smart devices today, almost even if you take like a car, it generates data continuously and sends it to a centralized location, which are more like activity that the car performs at various point in time. And these are like time series in nature. And energy forecasting is another one. These are some of the use cases. Energy forecasting is another one use case where typically you want to understand the user demand for electricity and accordingly manage your production. Or maybe if you are overproducing it, you may want to sell in an open market. But these are some of the examples of time series data. When we talk about time series data, there are key concepts that we need to understand. The data can have some trends, the data can have seasonality, the data that is generated may have some cyclical pattern. Typically, people get confused with seasonality and cyclic, but I will explain what it is. And then the data can be non-stationary, and some of the modeling technique that we use assumes the data to be stationary. So we may have to maybe make the non-stationary data stationary. So in this video, I'm just going to talk about the concepts. In the further video, in the future video, I will talk about statistical techniques that can be used to identify whether there's a trend or seasonality or even if the data is stationary or not. So let's start with trend. So basically, a trend exists when there's a long-term increase or decrease in the data. So if you see this particular graph, right, this is the International Air Travel Series. So if you see, basically, the data is continuously increasing. Starting from your 1949 till 1961, the air travel pattern has been continuously increasing. And along with the increasing, you can see also the seasonality. Maybe every year, towards the end of the year, the travel peaks and then it comes down. So when we talk about trend, the trend can be either an increasing trend or in some cases, it can be a decreasing trend also. And this trend need not be linear. It can be like increasing and then it can plateau and then again start a increasing or decreasing trend, right? And there can be changing direction as well in the trend. So when we say changing direction, what happened, like it may go from an increasing trend to a decreasing trend. So think about like the COVID scenario, right? Some of the companies might have an increasing sale trend because of the COVID. There was a lot of lockdown and some restaurants were closed or some retail shop were closed, and the sales may completely go to a declining trend. So this is one thing, like when we talk about time series data, we need to understand whether there is a trend in the data. In some cases, you may have to retrend as well for the modeling technique to work, right? So this is the first part. The second is seasonality within data. Now, a seasonal pattern occurs when a time series is affected by typically a regular occurring pattern, right? That means every year, maybe every month, maybe to the end of the month, the sales may pick up, right? Or every week, the weekend sales may go up. Or during the holiday season, every year during the November, December month, retailers that Walmart and JCPenney or Amazon might have higher sales because of the holiday season and everything. So that might be some seasonality in the data, right? Now, what can happen is the seasonality in this case is always fixed. So what is even is fixed, that typically if the data increases during the month of November, when there's a peak in the month of November seasonality, the sales increases, it may happen every year during November, right? So that's what we call typically the seasonality is fixed. And that's where the cyclic nature completely differs, where the cyclic can be because of any event or external event, like typically commodity prices may crash because of the underlying demand in the commodity, right? That can be one reason. Or the gold prices might happen. There is a kind of recessionary scenario. So these are all cyclic in nature. You cannot predict the pattern. So these are all not seasonal. These are cyclic. Now, if you see this four graph, there are like additive and multiplicative. So let me first talk about what is this additive and multiplicative. So this additive decomposition, right, what we call, is basically the magnitude of the seasonal fluctuation. You see here in the additive scenario, the magnitude of the seasonal fluctuation is almost like constant, right? Basically, there is not a lot of variation. But in case of multiplicative, same thing here. If you see there's a trend here, there is no trend. Basically, it's flat. It's centered around mean, right? But here you can see there's a positive trend. But still, the trend is basically constant. The fluctuation in the trend is pretty constant. But if you see below in the multiplicative, with no trend, you can basically see there is a fluctuation in the data, right? Basically, there's an increasing pattern over here. So basically, these are all multiplicative multiplicative decomposition. These are all additive seasonality or decomposition. So that's what we call multiplicative and additive. So the main thing is seasonality is always fixed. So when the data rise or fall is not fixed in nature, right? Then typically what we call it is cyclic. And the cyclic can happen because of some business cycles or economic cycles. So this is more seasonality. And a lot of business today have seasonality. If you take a retail industry, it may have seasonality during the year end. If you take even the weekday sales during the weekend, maybe some retail industry sees like larger demand in customers than the normal day. All of the business, if you take an electricity consumption, typically during the weekend, the electricity consumption is higher in those because a lot of people tend to stay at home, right? So all seasonality almost exists everywhere, right? So that is seasonality. The next is stationary. Now, when we call the data, stationary, is basically when the mean is constant, when the standard deviation is constant, and there is no seasonality or trend, right? Now, first two is very important. The third one, there are techniques where which we can make the data stationary, right? But the first two is very important. If you take the first graph on the top, the stationary time series, you can see basically the data is fluctuating, but it's fluctuating around its mean. Right, it's centered at zero. But what is going to happen is like even the standard deviation is basically kind of constant. It's not varying, right? And there you don't see much seasonality. Is it over here or trend over? There's no positive or negative trend. There may be seasonality over here where there are some peaks, but it's not clear. So that's where we run some statistical tests to understand it. And here we run the ADF test, and it is telling basically there's no the time series is stationary. Now, when we talk about non-stationary over here, basically you can see there is an the data is not centered around mean. Basically, the data is going from the zero mean and it's coming all the way to kind of the negative region, right? Even the standard deviation seems to be, it can be any one of it. It need not be all three together. The mean may not be constant, or the mean may be constant and the standard deviation may not. There are multiple factors that come into play. And here, if you see over here, the standard deviation is also not constant. And there seems to be some kind of trend. There's a negative trend over time. So this is non-stationary time series. The third one is white noise. Basically, the time series that shows no autograph correlation are called white noise. So what is autocorrelation test? Try to understand. Now, when we compare two variables, right, what we try to find out the how these variables are related, we use Pearson correlation function. And that Pearson correlation is used to compare two variables. But when we call autocorrelation, the name itself suggests, autocorrelation is correlation within itself. So the time series, basically what we call is the correlation between previous time period and itself is called autocorrelation. So how correlated the data points are at time t. So let's say like time t is some 1 o'clock and we are collecting an hourly data. So how correlated the data is with the previous time period 12 o'clock or the previous two time period 11 o'clock. So basically autocorrelation is correlation within itself. Right. So white noise is basically when you have no correlation at all, and that's called white noise. And typically when you model a time series, the output error residual will be stationary and will look kind of an white noise. And that's when you know your model is the best model and it has fitted well. Right. So that's stationary. And you need to remember a few things. Right. Now, time series can be irregularly spaced. It need not be regular. Right, so typically what happens is like you collect every hour data, it can be every hour, but in some cases it can be irregular, and there are different ways of handling irregular data, and I will explain it when I go into the detailed video. And there can be a lot of missing data as well, right? Like basically your sensor may go down when you're collecting the data, so there can be missing data, and we will see how to handle missing data in this case. Typically you cannot do a global mean or global median in this case. You need to do some smart imputing of data, right? Now you need to understand seasonality and cyclic, and this can be confusing, but I gave you an example. Seasonality is basically you are seeing the same behavior or pattern over time during this at the same period, right? But in case of cyclic, it is completely a business cycle dependent or economic cycle dependent. And when you're doing time series, right, most time series, majority of the time you spend is on data analysis. The basically data analysis is the key for time series data. The more time you find on data analysis, you can keep your model as simple as possible, right? So these are some things to remember. I will come in detail in my next video, but don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Click on the subscribe button that is coming in, and also hit the bell icon so that you get notified on future such videos. Thank you very much.